Heyo everyone, and welcome to a brand new experiment that I'm trying out. We're going to be playing a strategy game because I'm quite thoroughly sick of platforming games at the moment and need something else to calm my mind. This, everyone, is Warlock Master of the Arcane. Warlock Master of the Arcane is very similar to other strategy games such as Civilization and Master of Magic. In fact, you might say that this game is a bit of a hybrid of the two. The idea is that you take control of cities and build your forces and try to take over the world. But you do it with magical creatures instead. You use spells and you build up your forces, which are like something you'd see in some sort of Tolkien novel. It's pretty interesting. I have no idea how I'm going to make this interesting, because they're a little bit slower than normal games, so I'll think of something. Okay, disclaimer. I am not very good at strategy games. I'm okay at them, but I always make silly little mistakes which end up screwing me hard in the long run. As usual, this is an Iron Man game. I'm only going to be saving it when I exit the game and maybe when I finish recording, so if I make a stupid mistake which causes me to lose, well then so be it. Let's start up a new game of Warlock Master of the Arcane. Okay, this is the first loading screen. Or not a loading screen, this is the first setting screen in which we can set up the games. We can select the difficulty of the game, relaxed, casual, normal, challenging, and impossible. I'm not very good, but I don't really want to make me feel like the game's going easy on me, so I think normal's a very good difficulty level to start on. I think it should be interesting, so hooray, let's try it on normal mode. Next window will be the world's configuration. This is where we can set what type of world we want to play on, how many rival great mages we will be fighting, and other fantastic things like that. At the moment, we can see what type of land will be generated. At the moment, we can pick Great Lands, which is like big, massive land, no oceans anywhere. There's no need for ships and everyone just fights over the earth. Supercontinent's very similar to Great Land, only it's surrounded by an ocean. So oceans and ship combat plays a little part of it if you're on the coast, but for the most part you'll be fighting over land. Next step up there is continents, which means that there's one or two big massive land areas which we're going to be fighting over. Usually the players get divided up between however many continents the world generates, and we go on from there. And finally, we get islands, which is a whole bunch of really small land masses where ship and naval combat plays a big part of it, and island hopping is a big mechanic. I think continents is pretty good, so I think I'm going to stick with that one. I don't want the game to go on for too long, because I'm afraid of the game getting stagnant and kind of getting boring, so I'm going to change the map from large to normal, which I think is a reasonable size. And to make things interesting, I'm going to have four great rival mages, so we're going to be in a lot of contact with a lot of people, and there'll be a lot of brawling, because we love brawling, don't we? We can select whether the world will be cylindrical, which means that if you go to the far right-hand side of the map, you'll flip around to the left-hand side, and so on and so forth, or it can just be flat, which means that, yeah, you can't do that. Let's keep it cylindrical, because I think that's a little bit interesting. We can also set how many additional worlds there'll be. These are kind of like alternate planes. If you've ever played a game such as Master of Magic being one of the games, Age of Wonders, the Wizard's Throne has additional worlds, at least in Shadow Magic it did. It had the Underground and the Shadowlands, and this kind of works like that. By having more additional worlds, It just makes the game a little bit more tricky because more neutral monsters of elemental origin come rampaging forth to destroy all your hard work. So we'll just have two additional worlds. We don't want things to get a little bit too crazy. So we select next, and this is where we get to select our wizard. The game does have several pre-built wizards you can select from. Mirabilis the Hat, Anna the Benign, Nicholas Frost, the Grand Librarian, El Piritizer the Eternal, the Empress, King Lich the Fifth, Rakaj, King Rat. The 40 seconds? Sol D. Torvagar. Ashar the Wisest. Tendrils, and you get the picture. There are three races to pick from. I've only got one expansion to this game, that expansion being some heroes thing. But if you buy one, then apparently get a new race. So that's kind of fun. We'll be customizing our wizard, so that'll be something to do. I think we're going to go with Nicholas Frost, because the idea of a really aggressive warmongering Santa Claus is just really funny to me. So we'll be playing as Nicholas Frost, but we won't be having his default perks, which is Ice Ring, Lesser Heal, Mana Vault, and Conjurer. We'll be customizing him. Alright, so this is where we can remove his existing perks, and then think about what we're going to give him instead. We can also change his race, from humans to monsters to undead. I think we're going to stick with humans for now, because the other races have these quirks and I'm not terribly good with them. I can't really deal with that. So yeah, that'll be great. Now we get to select perks. On the left of each perk, we can see how much these perks cost. And if we look at the top, we can see that we have 10 points. Getting one starting good spell may be worth it, but then again, spells are generally easy to research and don't take that much effort. I might just pick up Ice Ring, just because whenever I've used it, it's just been a really, really badass spell. And he's Nicholas Frost. He needs Ice Ring. What else? Might pick up Treasury. I like having a little bit of extra gold at the start of the game, so my options get increased. I might pick up... Let's take a look. Trader, that seems pretty good. I can also pick up a Master of Blades or a Demonic Advisor, but I might not. In fact, no, I'll pick up a Master of Blades. That seems pretty cool. Now we've got one more point. Our Master of Blades is an example of a hero unit. They're very strong. They're much more powerful than your regular units. And having one at the start of the game is a huge benefit to you, because you've already got a unit which can fight and deal lots of damage before anyone else can have a chance to retaliate. I think we'll be good with the Master of Blades. Let's take a look at the other options, and we'll pick up Lesser Heal, I guess. So, he's very similar to the other Nicholas Frost. If I wanted to, I could get favor with the god, but not sure I want to do that. They also give some sort of special benefits in the form of a spell to you. But, yeah, I think I'll be fine with Ice Ring and Lesser Heal. That's one way of actually beating the game. You can go all the way in favor of one god, and then that god's evil counterparts, or just different counterpart, will send his avatar to crush you. If you defeat that avatar, you win. So that's an option to win the game, but I think I'm going to go with just crush and kill everyone. That sounds pretty solid. Alright, now with all the options in place, we can play start game! And we can see what the random generation is going to give us. Our situation is...
You have received a new request, my lord.
Yes, in case you can't tell, there is a nice, funny Sean Connery impersonator in this game. And in as most of the games by this developer. Alright, so let's take a look at our situation at the moment. We've got a starting city, Valencia. That's a pretty terrible starting city name. I think we can do a little bit better than that. Let's call it... Well, we're Nicholas Frost. We shall call ourselves Christmas Town. Our starting city will be the Christmas Town. And I believe you can also rename your units as well. If I remember how to do that... But it's not something I particularly care about at the moment, so I'll just ignore it. Okay. We've got three units available to us. We've got our hunters, we've got our rogues, and we've got our Hyde Blade Master. Our Hyde Blade Master is a very effective unit, but he's got some massive upkeep, so that's a little bit annoying to deal with, especially since if my food goes into the negatives, then my cities suffer something called starvation, which is not good at all. On the right hand side, we can see new stuff that we have to do before the turn ends. Alright, so we can select a new spell to research. This is our options. Harvest Blessing increases the food production of the target city. Healing heals 12 life magic. Make barren lands. Turns the landscape of the target hex to barren lands. Lesser Shadow Bolt. Straight up attack damage dealing spell. Range resistance, basic arrow resistance, and Harvest Blessing. I think Harvest Blessing is going to be really good, although it'll take 10 turns to research. So what I might do at the start is pick up Lesser Shadow Bolt. That's just a cheap single target damage attack spell, which is going to be good for nuking down any targets which are going to be annoying. This game doesn't really have a tech tree per se, but new technologies, or rather units, become available depending upon your city size. So as the city grows bigger, I'll be able to build more buildings, and when I get more buildings, then I'll be able to support more units and make more specialized units. I'm a little bit worried about my food deficit at the moment. So
what
I might be doing, as you can see, every unit requires some sort of upkeep. As you can see, the rogues require 2 gold in upkeep. My Hyde Blade Master requires 8 gold and 4 food in upkeep. And my hunters require 1 gold and 1 food in upkeep. I really don't want to start the game behind everyone else with my food deficit, so what I might actually do, and this might be a very controversial decision, which is no doubt going to screw me very, very hard, but I'm going to disband my group of hunters. Once I do that, my food should be in the surplus, and at the very least, my town will no longer starve. Fantastic! Alright. It's also prompting us to construct a building. As cities gain in size, this is a size 4. It can support 4 buildings around it. At the moment, they've got 3 buildings. A warrior's guild, which enables me to recruit veterans and warriors, a market, which increases my gold production, and a farm, which increases my food production. I can take a look at the left and realize that some buildings require other buildings to build. Since I've got a farm, I have the option of building a warrior's guild and a granary. I've already got a warrior's guild, but I also have the option of building a granary, which increases my food production by 50%, but it takes 2 gold in upkeep. I'm sorry if I'm boring. I can kind of cut down on the whole big tutorial speech if need be, but we'll see how this turns out. I think it'll be fun. I think. At the moment, I'm a little bit worried about my food, since food also gets converted into gold, surplus food gets converted into gold. Food's generally a very good thing to build up right at the start. So what I might do, as the ruler of Christmas Town, St. Nicholas Frost, I'm going to build a granary. Throw it there. And that'll get built. Once that gets built, it will come into effect. And I should be starting to generate even more food. So that should be great, shouldn't it? I hope so. Anyway, let's take a look at what else we've got. A new quest. Quests are things which come up from time to time which enable us to do something in exchange for a reward. In this case, it says, kill the dangerous wild animals. I kind of like wild animals. I think if they kind of leave us alone, if we leave them alone, they'll leave us alone, but it's a quest and they want us to kill it for 60 gold. If I fail, then it takes 20 gold from my treasury. Alright. As we can see, the bears are there. They're in the swamp. And I have the option of killing them. Enemy at the gate, which is drawing me attention to the bears, and the fact that towns, like in Civilization 5, if you ever played that, have the option of, kind of throwing like a ranged attack. Towns have ranged attacks, which is kind of cool. It represents, I guess, the natural defenders just throwing out arrows and whatever they've got to any attackers which are on the borders. And it's drawing attention to the fact that I've got 2 idle units and the fact that I can now recruit warriors in Christmas Town due to the fact that I've got my Warriors Guild. Well, that's the situation at the moment. So with that in mind, I think I've got some bears to slay. I've got 2 units to which to do that. Rogues and my Highblade Master. My Highblade Master, as you can see, has a lot more hit points than my rogues do. So I'm going to soften the bears up and try to take as minimal damage as possible, because weaker units don't deal as much damage as units with more hit points do. So the first step is to click on this little archery icon on my town, which will expend my ranged attack. I click on the bears and then arrows fly out and deal 10 damage to the bears. They've got 20 hit points left, and I need some way of expending them. Next up, I'm going to attack them with my Hideblade Master. My Hideblade Master deals 16 in melee damage, and he's got a special ability called Master Cleave. Area effect, target and 2 adjacent hexes. Inflicts melee damage to 3 units in front of the caster. And this is a little bit of lore. Schwartz, the Terminator, become the Hideblade Master because no one ever dared to answer his simple question. I'll be for the boss. Any questions? Alright, fantastic. So, he's up next. Let's move him in. And make him attack the bears. Thunk! Smash! Slash! Damage! And he managed to kill him. Mostly because the bears were standing on some bad defensive terrain. Swamps are very hard to defend and they give you defense penalties if you stand on them. Anyway, hooray, we got 60 gold pieces, and that's great. My rogues need orders, they've got high amount of movement, so I have the option of moving them somewhere very far out to scout out. As I can see, I've got a silver resource there, another silver resource there, and an ancient ruins. They're examples of special building. I can build special buildings there. I'll explain those a bit later. Not now. A bit later. Hold your horses, demanding viewers. Alright, so let's make our rogues scout this way and see what they can uncover. Well, we found a garbage dump and a whole bunch of cockroaches infesting the garbage dump. Lovely. So let's use our rogues to get some experience and attack these cockroaches. The rogues can move one more square a turn, sorry, hex a turn before attacking, so I'm going to move them up to the plains. And then attack the cockroaches. Good thing I moved that extra square, because over here I see the very, very faintest hint of a border, which means that either a rival or a neutral party is right next to me. The faster I meet them, the better things will be for me. So I have the option of building some warriors, but due to the fact my food's almost about to go into deficit, I think I'll hold off on purchasing the warriors. Unless I queue them up, and they should be done in by the time the granary's finished. So by the time the granary's finished, I may have enough food to support an additional troop of warriors. Rogues attack the cockroaches! Everyone takes damage. The cockroaches lost that battle. And when they lose the battle, or rather get routed, then they're forced to retreat to square. And then the attacking unit gets to move into the square to occupy that place. The rogues, the cockroaches retreated into the jungle, and the rogues took the garbage dump. Looted the garbage dump and found some gold. Just hanging out in a garbage dump, you know. Anyway, that's the end of the first turn. It took some time, so let's end the turn. The monsters get an opportunity to move. And now it's my turn. Alright, so first thing I notice, some skeletons have appeared right to my left. I don't think that they're neutral creeps. They might be, but they could be enemy units from a rival. So, since our High Blade Master is not really doing anything special at the moment, I'm going to move my High Blade Master right next to the skeletons. Since they're ranged, they don't have very strong melee defenses. And then move them up to attack the archers. This is a little bit of a hard battle for my High Blade Master, as we can see down in the little description here. His attack power is decreased by 25 due to the fact that the skeleton archers are in the hills. In addition, they get a plus 50% power bonus due to the fact that my High Blade Master is fighting up a hill. But he's much stronger than those skeleton archers are, so if I engage combat with them, he should be able to easily defeat them and make them rout. And we can indeed see that there's a neutral town of evil undead just waiting to be captured by me. Fantastic! The rogues, I think, are going to go up and finish the cockroaches because I want them to get a little bit of experience points. Once they get enough experience points, they'll level up. And once they level up, they'll get new abilities which will make them more useful in combat. My gold's still at a deficit, but since I've still got some food, I can happily continue knowing that Christmas Town isn't going to starve anytime soon. If I end the turn, stuff will happen. And it should be my turn again soon. Very soon. Okay, so as what we can see is that Hogwoods did a ranged attack against my High Blade Master, but my High Blade Master's armor pretty much negated all of the damage it dealt. So that was great. In addition, those skeleton archers, which were being a pain, got crushed by wild rat men. Neutral monsters sometimes don't like each other. So that's good for me, because if they're not fighting me, they're fighting themselves. Let's move our rogues to the right and see if we can investigate this neutral place over there. And we can see that Darkwing is here. Darkwing appears to be another undead castle. It might be, it could be humans. I'm not sure, I can't tell. But I do notice that both of them are right for the conquering. Uh-oh. My food's in deficit again. I do need to do something about that. I think Christmas Town is getting some food penalty due to the fact that there are desert hills now within its radius, which is not very good. It's not very good at all. I have no way of supporting myself, and Christmas Town will start to starve if I don't actually find some food in order to stop that from happening. Alright, as we can see, the High Blood Master leveled up. So how about we level him up? Select a perk to level him up with. Cover Specialist, Defensive Bonus on Rugged Terrain, Blade Wall, plus 30 melee resistance, and Furious Charge, plus 20% melee. Since he's going to be my bruiser and damage dealer, I'm going to give him Furious Charge. Move him right next to Hogwarts. And then use his ability, Master Cleave, which should enable me to attack both Hogwarts and the Wild Ratmen which are beside him. I've never used a Blade Master before, so this should be interesting. Master Cleave on the Wild Ratmen. And okay, that did not work the way I expected it to. Alright, so if I activate Cleave, select a tile, then it'll select the two adjacent tiles to attack. I wish I knew that before actually activating the ability, but whatever. I get to build a new unit in Christmas Town. The new unit is Peasant Settlers. Peasant Settlers will enable me to expand and build new cities. That's very important. The more cities we have, the more resources we'll pull in. So I'm going to queue up to build a Peasant Settlers as soon as my warriors are done, because the slower I actually pump out Desolate Settlers, Peasant Settlers, then the more I'll fall behind in the game. At least that's what I've learned. And with my High Blade Master, I don't really need to be that concerned about defense. I do need to be concerned about keeping him alive, but not too much about my own defense.
Congratulations! You have successfully researched a new spell, my
okay,
lord.
So this is what's happened. High Blade Master got attacked by Hogwarts, which was not good. He needs a little bit of help to take over Hogwarts, so what I'm going to do is make him rest. He's going to recover some hit points and get ready to attack Hogwarts.
Attention!
I recruited some warriors. Warriors are like mini versions of my High Blade Master. They're pretty defensive, they're pretty strong, so I'm going to move them up to start laying siege to Hogwarts. What else? Christmas Town grew in, well, that it already happened, but it managed to build that granary after all. And the granary increases the city's food population, which means that I'm no longer starving, which is fantastic. I also get to build a new building in there. I'm not sure if I should have done that last turn, because I can't remember. Time to talk about special resources. This is a silver resource. We can all see. Resource, silver. Planes, production, food, plus 20%. I can build special buildings on resources, and this particular special resource is giving me one of two options. I can decide to build a silver mine on the silver resource, which will increase the gold production of the town. Very useful if I decide to make this, if I decide to make Christmas Town a very gold-centric city. But I don't think I will. I think I'm going to wait until I get... I don't know, I could. When Christmas Town expands once again, it's got another gold resource there. So I could make it very gold heavy. In fact, I might do that. Never mind, I've changed my mind. I'm going to focus on getting lots of gold in Christmas Town. Say if I didn't want a silver mine though, I could go down and build a Silverwalk Armory instead. Now, as you can see, a Silverwalk Armory will actually take away gold from my pool, but it'll give me a perk which I can apply to my units. Silver Weaponry. I'm not exactly sure what Silver Weaponry does at the moment. I think it's just increased damage. But if I build my Silverwork army, I'll be able to equip my armies with silver weapons. That seems a little bit excessive at the moment, and I'm already having a pretty massive gold deficit. So what I might do is instead build my silver mine. With my silver mine in play, I'll get 6 more gold and start getting a profit. The rogues are in the jungle, getting attacked by Darkwing. The city, not the duck. And I'll move my rogues around so they can... No, as a matter of fact, I'm going to move my rogues up and explore and see if I can find a good site for a second city. Lost caravan. An elven village. And a magic node. Okay. These are two examples of special resources. So, I think I'm going to build my next city right here in the sandy desert. It will be a very magic central place. I'll be able to use that place to build wizards and things once they expand to that. And there's also an elven village. And if I manage to expand to the elves, then I'll be able to build special elvish units, which are superior archers. And since that's kind of like my mid-term strategy, I don't need to worry about building a ranger's guild there because human rangers are vastly inferior to elvish rangers. So that's our strategy, guys. We're going to go up and make friends with the elves, but not at the moment because we've got some research to do. We learned lesser Sertobolts, and now we can learn something else. What I might do is pick up ranged resistance because this town will start flinging more and more arrows at me, and that's a bit of a pain. If I put ranged resistance on my units, then I won't need to worry about that as much. I can cast Lesser Heal on my Hyde Blademaster, but I don't think that's necessary. I think we're done. End turn, see what happens. As expected, they flung more arrows at poor Mr. Hyde Blademaster here, but that's nothing. A little rest and relaxation won't be able to cure. Going to move my warriors through the desert hills to approach Hogwarts and then do a two-pronged attack on that evil undead place and bring them to my side. My rogues need orders, so I'm going to make them loot the caravan, see what they find in that. And they've also run across some skeleton warriors. Since my rogues have taken a little bit of damage, I'm going to retreat them and to make them rest because they're going to have to protect the caravan, which I'm going to send up that way from those skeleton warriors. I also need to check over here to make sure that nothing's going to sneak around and attack me. More arrows get flung.
You have received a new request, my lord.
My peasant settlers get recruited. Gonna move them up. Slowly and surely, and move them eventually there. That's a good spot to put them in because both the reason I could put them there, but then they're closer to Darkwing City, and I think that that's actually too close to Darkwing City, so I can't construct there anyway. It'll need to grow a size before it can access the Dead Woods and the magic node, but that's not a big problem. My rogues are going to rest and restore some hit points. My two units are going to move into Hogwarts
warriors
to try to capture it. And I can see that there's a magic fields there. So lots and lots of magic. Maybe I might go very... Well, Santa Claus is very magical, isn't he? Yeah, I think that'll work. New quest. I need to build a farm. My reward is 90 gold. I think that's reasonable. I think I'm going to be building a farm with my new caravan, so okay. I'll build you a farm. Also, another thing, once you build buildings, I do not believe that you can remove them from... Oh wait, yes, I can in fact remove the buildings. You didn't used to be able to do that because being able to swap and change was considered to be a little bit overpowered, because you could get what you wanted and then just demolish what you didn't need. But you do take a penalty if you want to demolish it. Essentially, you're going to destroy the building, destroy everyone in it, and your population will go down. I assume that's how it goes. So, yeah. That's just another option I can keep in mind. They're going to defend their town, which is going to be a paltry effort. Admirable, but ultimately useless. My High Blade Master leveled up for some reason. They probably shot arrows at him, but he just laughed it off. And I think I'm going to get Furious Temper to complement his Furious Charge. Now he's a very angry berserker kind of character who's going to march into this town and show everyone who their daddy is. Alright, it's damaged the skeleton warriors inside and dealt some damage to the city itself. Once the city reaches 0 hit points, I'll be able to march into it. Following up my Blade Master, I'm going to march my warriors in. They're not going to do as much damage, but they're going to do their parts to whittle down the defenses. My rogues are going to rest a little bit more so they get up to full hit points, and I think I'm going to cast my first spell of the game. If I click on this little magic symbol icon, then I can pull up a lesser heal. This shows the information about the spell, a little icon which pretty much determines what the spell is. Its mana cost, its name, and then finally how long it takes to cast. As you can see up here, there's a blue ring around the spellcasting panel. That shows me how much magical channeling I've got left to cast in the spell. As you can see, depending upon the spell, it requires different amounts of power to cast. A lesser heal takes about a third of a turn, and a lesser shadow bolt takes a full turn to cast. What I'm going to do is prep lesser heal, and throw it on my warriors to make sure that they're back up to full strength, or at the very least, close enough to it. That took away from my mana supply, it took a bit of my channeling energy, but it did give them a bit more durability, which is what they need since they're sieging the town. End turn, see what happens. My settlers moved up a bit, more defending of their town, and more destruction of their town, which is going to occur right now. He scores a massive critical hit on Hogwarts and brings it down to near death. My warriors are going to do their part in the sieging of Hogwarts, and that's fantastic. My rogues are going to move up and prepare to defend the caravan from any warriors which might decide to run down and spoil my day. I'm going to move my peasant settlers up. And maybe move my rogues down one square just so they don't provoke the skeleton warriors. The skeleton warriors also have a sight radius. Well, the AI is supposed to have a sight radius. Whether or not it actually does that is a different story. And what I might do is build another peasant settlers in my town, because I want to expand pretty fast and not fall behind. Although I am going to get quite a lot of support since I'm about to attack and take over Hogwarts. High Blade Master attack! And he takes over Hogwarts! Hogwarts is now mine! If I double click on it, I can see that it is an undead town. I can't build any units within it, since it has no buildings to recruit any units. So it looks like very soon I will have an undead wing to my army. And Hogwarts, it sounds okay, I guess, but it's not very Christmassy. What I might do is call this Halloween Town. Da 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 da. Gonna recruit Jack Skellington from that place, and hopefully
Warriors.
Have a nice, happy undead, which will do my bidding. My warriors, they're going to be a bit more defensive than my blade master, so what I'm going to do is give them blade wall instead. And apparently that also increased their sight radius, which is fantastic. What they're going to do now is going to go down and start defending from these ballsy hunters which decided to approach for some reason. Die, hunters! Who the hell do you think you are, marching on my town like that? Rogues are kind of okay at the moment. Make them defend, move my peasant settlers up one square. And things are looking good. I'm recruiting peasant settlers in my place. I've got a spell I can cast, but my mana supply isn't that great. Undead love mana. Undead essentially don't need to eat, like, say, humans and beasts, but what they do require is a lot of magic in order to support their forces. As you can see, Halloween Town is only size 1, so it's going to take them a little bit of time in order to build up to Christmas Town. The little castle icon to the left of the name of the town indicates its stage of development. As you can see, Halloween Town is just very small. It's only got basic walls, but Christmas Town has big castle walls, and that makes the whole world of difference. It's got some time to go before it builds up its towers and makes itself truly the capital it's meant to be, but we'll get there eventually. If we take a look at the map, we can see that my influence has expanded, and Halloween Town is pulling in resources which are getting added to my pool up here. Everything is going swimmingly. We'll end the turn and see what happens next. I'm going to make my high blade master. Well, I can move him on. He's not going to be that useful standing there, so I'm going to move him out. And start moving him up here to investigate the city up here and perhaps have my second conquest. End turn. Oh no, the archers are shooting poor, defenseless Halloween Town.
You have successfully researched a new spell, my lord.
Well, thank you very much. It's not like I was able to not be able to tell that myself. Anyway, it'll take a little time for Halloween Town to build up its defenses and recover from the big siege which it just was just through. But that hit point bar will eventually fill up until it's back up to full strength. Since it's my town, it's got the option to shoot at any enemies which lay siege to it. So if I click that, then click the hunters, they'll throw out arrows and deal a little bit of damage to the hunters. Not that much, but enough to count. Then my warriors are going to attack and try to force them back from my newly acquired lands. They're rather persistent. They don't seem to want to retreat very much. Move my rogues up. Move my peasant settler up. Make my peasant settler found my second city.
We have founded a new city.
Well, basically, I kind of cheesed the quest because the very first building, the free building you get for every new place is a farm. So yes, I was able to complete the quest just by founding a new city. Hooray for me! We have founded Gouda. Gouda is size 1, just like Halloween Town. And yeah, it's got a lot of building to do before it builds up to be a great area to live. And a nice defensive bastion. So that's going to be something. I need to wait until it grows before I can build anything else, so at the moment it's pretty helpless. I don't even think I can destroy the farm at the moment. No, I can't. I don't think that's a very good idea. So let's close the city view and instead take a look at the rogues, which can move up there and attack the skeleton warriors, but skeleton warriors are a little bit tougher than my rogues are. So it may be a bit of a silly idea to walk up and attack them. So what I might do is instead move my rogues out to scout another place. Okay. So there are goblin spearmen over there. And skeleton warriors. It looks like the Garuda is going to be very active. That's a terrible name. Needs to rename Garuda to something a little bit more festive. Well, since I've got an elf village right now, I can get some Christmas elves. So, what am I going to call this town? Jolly Elf Village. That'll do! So now we've got Christmas Town, Jolly Elf Village, and Halloween Town. That's wonderful. And my camera has locked in place for some reason. Oh, this game and all its glitchiness, but I still love it. Since we just researched a spell ranged resistance, we have the option to select a new spell to research. This time I think we're going to get melee resistance just to cap off our big defensive list. I'm going to cast range resistance on my High Blade Master. If I cast it inside my town, I get to recover some of the mana cost. So if I cast it outside of my town, outside of my borders, it'll cost me 20 mana. But if I cast it inside, it'll still cost me 20 mana, but I'll get refunded 10 of that mana. So it's really useful to do. Let's move him up and see what's else to destroy. A lost caravan and yeah, nothing else.
Yeah.
We also get the option of moving our second peasant settlers around. We've expanded up that way a bit. This area is still a bit unknown, so what I might do is move them this way and settle somewhere around here. Okay, so let's end our turn. The neutrals are walking up to attack my rogues. How dare they? And it looks like the skeletons want some. So we're in a little bit of trouble up there. But fortunately, it's not absolutely terrible yet. I'm going to move my rogues back to the castle, Jolly Elf Village, where they'll enjoy some extra defense. And then have the elves, or rather, the humans who occupy this village at the moment, fire upon the approaching skeleton archers, which do have a considerable amount of missile resistance, so that's not terribly great. I've got enough peasant settlers at the moment. I could build another one, but I'm sorely missing my warriors. So I'm going to recruit another group of warriors, and then decide what else I'm going to build. I could build a smithy, which upgrades to a barracks, which will upgrade to something else, which will enable me to recruit tier 2 units, but I don't think I'll do that yet. Tier 2 units are extremely expensive, and unless you've got the gold income to support them, they're really powerful. You'll be able to send them out and crush everyone, but you'll be hurting for gold. So I think we'll wait before picking up that. What we might do though is pick up the Rogues Guild, because that'll give us access to rogues and tax officers, which will increase our gold income. Very important, since we're about to build some a whole bunch of silver mines. We'll build our Rogues Guild up in the mountains. I think the rogues should be up in the mountains. So there they go. That's going to be constructed. And I'll be able to construct train rogues once that's done.
Blade Master
is going to go loot that lost caravan and find some gold. Unfortunately, he didn't find a way through the mountains, so that's a little bit of a pain. There's no way for me to cross those mountains unless I go the long way around. And I can fire on the hunters. Cast lesser heal on my rogues, actually. And then send them up to attack the hunters. Hopefully kill them. And then move on.
What now?
Well, there's a gold resource there, so I think I'll be settling next to the gold resource. The rogues have gained a level, so I get to pick something like that. Rogues are best when on the offense. So getting them defensive abilities, in my eyes and in my opinion, is not that worth it. End turn, see what happens. Fortunately, they're retreating, but the skeletons are moving up to attack. The rogues are doing a very, very admirable job in defending it. The city's going to shoot on the skeletons. I'm going to heal the rogues. And again, to give them a bit more attack power, and then retaliate on the skeleton warriors and hopefully drive them back. Unsuccessfully. Highblade Master is going to begin his trek through the woods, mountains, and find out that there's no way through there. Joyous occasion! I need to find some other way to capture that neutral village up there. But it looks like that neutral village is going to be safe for the time being.
Attention!
Warriors are going to go exploring down this way, and
settlers.
My peasant settlers are going to brave the forests and go next to the gold resource. I've already got Halloween Town next to a small ocean, but it's good to have kind of towns right next to the water, so I have the option of building boats if need be. So what I might do is found my next city about there. That looks like a good spot. They're still next to there, so I'm going to fire on them and hopefully kill them before they have a chance to escape. If I heal my rogues, bring them up to full health, it should increase the damage they will deal. And kill them! Kill them! How dare they attack us! The audacity! And they're dead, which means that all I need to do is deal with the archers now, which are a lot easier to do because archers are very weak in melee. The Blade Master's gonna go, "What's going on here?" And go perhaps take over Darkwing now. The idea was to take over whatever town this was up there, but since there's no way to go up to that town at the moment, I'm gonna have to content myself with attacking somewhere else. Warriors are going to continue through the forest and find some predator spiders. Let's just ignore them. Let's go back and not have anything to do with them. Apparently I can't do that. Oh great! Just provoked some freaking candy canes. But hopefully they didn't notice. So if we be very quiet, they can attack and kill my... Run away, you fools! Oh dear, this is going to be a little bit stressful.
Yes, my lord.
Good thing I...
Your excellency, someone has humbly requested your aid.
Oh my goodness, look at all this stuff which just popped up onto the right. Looks like I'm going to have to deal with that. Alright, can I get that away? The spiders have a movement of... 3.
Yes.
I move my peasants a little, but I think they can move freely through forests due to the fact that they're creatures. Well, I'm going to take a risk. Move settlers down here. Get ready to found the city. Move warriors up to defend against the candy canes. And then throw 2 heal spells on my warriors to hopefully protect them from the evilness of those guys. My High Blade Master might need to go down and defend this area, but maybe not. The capital's going to fire on the rats. As it gets in size, it grows in size, its ranged attack becomes stronger, and as you can see, it shot a fireball instead of that group of arrows. I'm going to have to defend against the giant spiders, which at the moment, my High Blade Master is the only one capable of dealing with them. I learnt melee resistance. I get to research a new spell, which will now be Harvest Blessing. And I get a new quest, to build a craftsman district. For 110 gold, yeah, sure, why not? I'll get around to it. Assigning unit orders. Move back into the village, please, and rest up. I have the option of building rogues in Christmas Town. So I'm going to start production of those. And some... Well, I've already got two warriors, so let's build two more rogues. And... That'll be great. It'll be fun once my cities grow in size and I'll get my elven village. But at the moment, I do not have that luxury.
Clear-eyed and ready.
Just adoptive defensive stance and try to attract their attention. Yes, fantastic. Ah, do not die! Good work, men. Good work, you protected the caravan. The caravan has founded New Lamidia.
A new city has been founded, my lord.
Okay, so what are we going to name this one? I have no idea. I have no idea what I'm going to be naming this one. I'll take some suggestions for the name of this town. Taking suggestions on the name of my new seaside town. And they're going to fire on the spiders, which are being a little bit of a pain at the moment. My warriors should now have the movement ability to kind of retreat. But no, they're stunned. So what I might need to do is... I don't even know if I want to heal them up because they're probably going to die. But what I can do at the very least... I feel bad. Let's try to heal them. Perhaps I can save them if they do manage to survive. Well, they clearly won't be able to because I won't be able to cast another heal spell. But if by some fluke of nature, the predator spiders decide to attack the town instead, then they'll have some valuable experience points. Rogues. Rest. And... You move up and barricade yourselves in the town. That sounds great. Oh no! They're dead. They're all dead. They're all dead. The evil candy canes have killed them. You have the option of constructing a building. You can build a graveyard. To recruit skeletons, we can build a market, which was required for bat forts and craftsman districts. We can build a harbour, which can build a Caralavis and an air dockyard. We can build a mana farm, which is required for a mana vault. You're right next to the water, with a magic node just outside your range, and those magic fields will eventually be in your range. So, I do want some undead units, so I'm going to build a graveyard right there. And hopefully start getting some fantastic skeletons in the group as well. Construct building. I've got my warrior's guild. That little tick just means that some other town in my place has got that built already, so I don't need to worry about that just at the moment. I could build a granary or a What are we going to do, guys? What are we going to do? I don't know. You tell me, I'm bad at these games. You need to speak louder, though. Well, I can build a mana trap, I guess. Oh, yeah, that's right. I was going to make this a wizard place. Mana trap. There. Fantastic. Closer to view. A trader has come. He's offering to sell me a flaming sword. I'll buy that flaming sword from you. It gives me plus 15 elemental damage. So if... Since I bought that sword, I can go to my lords and actually give my High Blade Master the Flaming Sword. And I need 20 mana in order to do so. Oh poo, I can't do that just yet. Enemy units appeared near your city or forts. Let's shoot them. Hit the town. And let's try to kill the candy canes before the turn ends.
Blah! Maid Masters don't like spiders!
Fantastic! That was relatively painless. Finally, we're going to march on Darkwing. That's great. Halloween Town is building up, Stay Tuned is just chilling and growing, and the Jolly Elf Village is eventually going to grow up and get those elves as part of their forces. Fantastic! I think I'm going to call it here, guys. It's been a really long episode. I'm not sure if this is going to be very good, but hopefully it will be fun. These videos are going to naturally be a little bit longer than every other video, so hopefully it won't be too boring. Thanks for watching, everyone, and goodbye for now.